Hello and welcome to worship today. I'm Pastor Janet Miller, and we're very glad that you could worship with us.
Our hymn is Come All Ye People, number 819. Number 819, Come All You People. Now, before we sing it, it is one that probably isn't familiar to you, but once you've heard it through once, you'll be able to sing it. It's very simple and very repetitive. And so we thought we would bring something new to you, but something that's kind of fun.
We begin each service with a time of confession and forgiveness. So let us pray. Gracious God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Jesus Christ is given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. So as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Our song is Just As I Am, number 592 in our red hymnals, Just As I Am.
Come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come.
Today's gospel reading comes from the book of John, the 11th chapter, and it is long. So there's like 45 verses. And so we will read from the gospel of John. Now, a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister. So the sisters sent a message to Jesus. Lord, he whom you love is ill. After having heard that Lazarus was ill, Jesus stayed 2 days longer in the place that he was. Then, after this, he said to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. After he'd said this, he told them, one of our friends, Lazarus, has fallen asleep, and I am going to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he has fallen asleep, then he will be all right. The disciples had been speaking about, or the disciples said this as they did not know what Jesus was speaking about. Jesus, however, had been speaking about Lazarus' death, but they thought that he was referring merely to sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus is dead. For your sake, I am glad I was not there, so you may believe, but we must go to him. When Jesus arrived, he found that Lazarus had been in the tomb for 4 days. Now, Bethany was near Jerusalem, some 2 miles away, and many of the Jews had come to Mary and Martha to console them about their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, while Mary stayed at home. Martha said to him, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that God will give you whatever you ask of him. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. And Mary said, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection of the last day. But Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. And whoever believes in me, though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. Do you believe this? And she said to him, Lord, I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, the one coming into the world. When she had said this, she went back to their house and she called Mary and told her privately, the teacher wants to speak to you. He's calling for you. When she heard this, Mary quickly got up and came to him, and those around her followed. When Mary and the people following her came to where Jesus was and saw him, she knelt down at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who came with her also weeping, he was greatly disturbed in spirit and deeply moved. Where have you laid him? And they said to him, Lord, come and see. And then Jesus began to weep. So the Jews said, so see how he loved him? But some of them said, could not he who opened the eyes of the blind have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, again greatly disturbed, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone was lying against it. And Jesus said, take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, already there's a stench, because it's been 4 days that he's been dead. And Jesus said to her, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus looked upward and said, Father, I thank you for having heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I say this for the sake of the crowd standing here, so that they may believe you sent me. And when he had said this, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! And the dead man came out. His hands and his feet were bound with strips of cloth, and his face was wrapped in a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Unbind him and let him go." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Well, let's pray. Loving Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. Well, my family in the late 60s and early 70s lived near Webster, South Dakota. My folks had a bakery in town, and we lived a couple miles out in the country. I suppose nowadays you'd call it like an acreage, but you know, we didn't have any fancy terms. We just lived in the country, and we didn't have a lot of land or anything. We had a great big old house, and we had enough land for pasture for some horses, and we had some chickens sometimes and different things like that from time to time, and a garden. Well, every year on this farm, and I was a little girl there, and every year on this farm, when springtime came, the cool thing happened. Across from us was this big hill, and on this big hill, you would see, once spring came, for a short amount of time, the prairie crocuses, or sometimes they're called pasque flowers, would come out and they would bloom. And they were so pretty. And my mother would take us out, and we would very carefully cross the highway. Highway 12 at that point only had one section of highway and not the two lane that it has now. And we would very carefully cross the highway and go over to this pasture. And we would pick these pasque flowers or crocuses or whatever you wanted to call them. We'd pick them. And they were so pretty. They were just little there. They didn't grow high there or anything. But they were really, really neat. And it was always special because it was a sign that spring had come and summer was coming and things like that. Well, after we did it for several years in my memory, I was just little at that point, but I remember at one point being with my brother David, and we were out picking, and he kind of half tripped over this, looked like a little indent in the ground. And as we looked at it and, you know, started to look around it, this indent seemed to be in some kind of shape. It seemed to be straight lines. And, you know, not a lot of things in nature are straight lines. So, of course, we had to look and see what it was. And we thought, well, is it like a box? Is it something for wires or something? We didn't know what it was. And we kind of tried to walk around it. And we couldn't figure out what this thing that was in the ground and obviously there was. It wasn't until you were farther away from it and looked back at it that you could see it was actually an odd shape of a cross on that hillside, and that the crocuses or pasque flowers had grown really thick in that section, and so it kind of stood out. Now, we had no idea why that had happened at that point. You know, we were just kids and had to go and report all the miracles that you see happen around you to adults. And at some point in this conversation, one of the adults around told us a story. They told us that back in the late 20s and early 30s, in this area, there was a group that had come called the Ku Klux Klan. And the Klan was a group of people who at that point really, really disliked black people or people of color at all, and that they came and protested and tried to make a lot of trouble in our area, and that it never quite took in our area, that it just didn't, people didn't join enough, or I don't know what it was, thank goodness. But one of the things that they had done while they were there is that they had a cross burning. And up on the hill across from our house was where the cross had been burnt. And so it had burnt, you know, rub things into the ground. I suppose maybe they had dug it to put the wood on it so that when you went by, you would see this cross burning up there. I'm sure that was a pretty dramatic thing to see. And apparently that's a Ku Klux Klan thing, burning crosses is. And so for a long time, that was a scar on that hill. Well, by the time we got there, in the late 60s, early 70s, it had been a long time since the 20s and 30s, right? We're not sure exactly what date this happened, but we know it was late 20s, early 30s that this happened up in the area. And so nature had done its deal. You know, if you leave something alone long enough, nature reclaims it and makes it its own. And so this thing that was this sign of darkness and hatred and just bad, this cross, had been reclaimed by nature. And all of the pretty pasque flowers had grown into it enough that you could see the outline of it along the hillside. You see, life always wins when you depend on the life of the light of God. Well, in our gospel lesson for today, we have a lesson where we're hearing about a time when it feels as if darkness has won. And it kind of even feels in part of the story like Jesus doesn't care if darkness is winning. You know, one of his good friends, we hear about Lazarus and we hear about Mary and Martha several times in the gospel. And we are always told there are people he have probably known all of his life. And there are people who have supported his ministry with money and have let them stay with him and things like that. And there are people that are his friends that he loves. And everybody knows that he loves them. They are special friends of Jesus. So one would think when your special friend is very ill, especially in the times when there wasn't medicine and there weren't doctors really to take them to, that Jesus, who was a healer, would have gone right away. But he doesn't. I can imagine what it must have been like to be Mary and Martha as they sat and waited for Jesus to get there. Or even the people who were with them as they, in confusion, waited, thinking, Jesus, what's going on? Aren't you going to do something? Doesn't the power of God need to be done? And yet, he didn't go. And Lazarus dies. His family have to go through the horrors of not just sickness, but death, and of having the time where they have to clean his body and wrap it in cloths and lay it in a tomb. What horrors. How let down must they have been when Jesus refused to come, when they thought he loved them. Well, Jesus, after his death, says it's time for us to go back, and he and the followers come back and are greeted with a grieving and angry first Martha and eventually Mary, who all talk to him, I assume, with Martha especially, because she was always kind of brash and out there, that she came to him with anger and said, what? Why didn't you come? If you had been here, he wouldn't have died. We know you have that power. And then they send Mary. And Mary and Jesus always seem to be closer than Martha and Jesus. She's the one who liked to sit at his feet and listen. Martha was kind of the go in the kitchen and get everything done lady. And Mary too comes to him and says, but Jesus, if he would been here, he wouldn't have died. And so Jesus takes them, has them take him, that is, to where they've laid him, and tells them that the glory of God is going to be shown and that this is going to be something wonderful. and tells them to open up the tomb. And they tell him the truth. They live in a desert area. And this guy's been dead for 4 days. 4 days! And death has a smell to it. It has a feel to it, a look to it, a smell to it. And they don't want to smell and see that about their brother. I can imagine them thinking, Jesus, haven't we hurt enough? I mean, you weren't here before. Why are you putting us through this now? But Jesus has them roll away the stone and calls out Lazarus from the dead. One of the things that it shows later on in the gospel is that he is not the walking dead. He's not a zombie. He's not a ghost. He eats and he talks and he touches to people things that people who are, you know, the walking dead kind of things wouldn't do. They want you to understand that he is put back into life. And it's great and it's wonderful. But does the glory and wonder erase all of the fear and sadness that happened before? We live in a world and a time where sometimes some of the things that are happening around us can convince us and make us feel as if not only does the darkness have power, but God really doesn't care if it does. I can empathize with those women. Where were you, God, when this happened? And how and why would you ever let it not? Because, as they said, we as people of God understand that God has the power. I mean, I'm sure even the people who are watching a cross burn on a hillside near their community had to have thought, where is God in the middle of this? When these people are desecrating both our town and the cross with hate. And those are normal, healthy, and okay questions to ask God. But we are reminded through a lot of Jesus' words today that God knows and has a plan, and that the plan is for good. That's something we need to hang on to, even in the darkest. And that God knows what's happening with you. That we are reminded in our Psalms so often that God walks through the valley of the shadow of death with us and never leaves us there alone, even though sometimes we look around and don't think we can see him. You know, being a caller of the light, bringing a person who testifies to the light, even and especially in bad times, can be dangerous. It could be dangerous for the people who stood up to that clan meeting and group way back when. It can be dangerous for those of us who go into something that seems as if it's God-forsaken and start to talk about God in it. People can get really mad, offended, hurt, even violent sometimes when you tell them about God having a plan in life and that God knows where they are. In Jesus' case, this act of healing of a friend that he loves to show the power of God, that this was in God's plan, this act is the act that finally tips the point against him. Where you read a little bit farther in the gospel, the rulers of that time, the Judean rulers and the Pharisees and scribes all get together and say, the word of this will travel and we can't stop it. And this is the kind of thing that's going to make people believe in him and go and try to overthrow the Romans. And we're all going to die. And so they say, it's better for one guy who can do this kind of stuff to die than for a whole nation to go. And so they begin the plot to put Jesus on the cross. Bringing a person to life brought Jesus to the cross. It's a crazy thought, isn't it? But yet we're reminded that God knew what he was doing. That as these signs and all of the things Jesus did coming up to this very last one, God had a plan that we will see come true on Holy Week as we remember the death of Jesus, and on Easter as we celebrate his resurrection. So today, when you're in the middle of whatever life is throwing at you, when it feels as if darkness has way more power than you do, I remind you that it does not have way more power than God has. And that our Savior is walking beside you. In Jesus' name, we hold on to the promises. Amen.
Our song is Prince of Peace, and it at the end has two separate things. What we'll do is we'll go through the chorus first together, then we'll go through one side of and we'll go through the other side. So the second verse and the third verse that we sing will be put together at the end, and the words will be underneath for you to be able to do. Underneath, I don't know how you're going to do it when it's separate.
I'll figure it out. Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Ready?
Yep. You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
The Lord be with you, and also with you. On this day, we pass the peace of Christ to you wherever you are. Know that God will come to you today. Peace be with you. And that you may carry God to someone else, offering them his peace and his love. Amen. We also have a time also, always that is, to remind folks about our tithes and offerings to our God. If you would like to help the people who sponsor this cast of worship, you may do so by sending to either Hope Lutheran Church at P.O. Box 886 in Summit, South Dakota, 57266. They also have automatic withdrawals and a Venmo. Hopefully the Venmo would be up around somewhere in the worship so you can take a few minutes to use it if you want to. And then I also have secondary congregations that I serve, which are not second in my heart, but second in time, our New Helgen Lutheran Church and Goodhue Lutheran Church. So if you would like to give to either of those, you may do so by sending to New Helgen Lutheran Church at P.O. Box 5 in Florence, South Dakota, 57235. And again, they have the opportunity to do automatic withdrawals as well. We thank you. We thank you for remembering God first and for giving back the portion of what we are so blessed to have. Amen. We continue on then with prayers for our people of God. You have breathed into the breath of life, Holy Father. Enliven your church. Deepen our partnership with our companion churches around the globe. We especially lift up the churches in Cameroon and Nicaragua, our sister synods, and all who serve there. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Your Spirit brings life and creation. Enliven the natural world. Help all in South Dakota, especially in our northeast corner, who are struggling with spring snowstorms and all of the snow that has come. We ask you help it to melt in a good manner so we aren't completely flooded, that you help us who work in it to be safe. We especially lift up those who move the snow and our first responders who go out when the roads are bad, and all of our police and all of our highway patrol who are out working to keep us safe in the snow. We ask your blessings on the farmers who work hard to move the snow and to get to their livestock and to keep things safe, especially those who are running out of their summer feed as we should be coming to spring here. We ask your blessings also as they are all coming into time of calving and lambing and other livestocks having their babies. Bless them, keep them safe, help their livestock. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for all those who suffer because of natural disasters or man-made disasters. We especially lift up the peace people of East Palestine, Ohio, as they continue to struggle with what has happened in their community, and the peoples of Turkey and Syria, who will for years need to work on rebuilding after the terrible earthquakes. We pray for the people of Ukraine and all who suffer because of war. Merciful God, receive our prayer. You weep when we weep. Be present with those who grieve and those who are troubled by illness. We especially lift up baby Lennon, Hunter, Carrie, Kelly, Susie, Karen, Donna, and all who we name in our hearts who are in need of your care. Merciful God, receive our prayer. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones to death. We especially lift up Lois and her family, praying that you help us all to remember that parting, grief is a parting, not an ending, and that we will meet again at our Savior's feet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your steadfast love and your promise to renew our whole creation through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Just one moment of announcement before we go to our Lord's Prayer. Lois Monahan, her funeral is coming up next week on Tuesday, and it will be at 4 o'clock. I'm sorry, I had to stop and think. I had a brain moment. It will be at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, and the reception will be at the community hall in Florence. So it'll be at New Helgen Lutheran Church at 4 o'clock in the afternoon. And so now, Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and with mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
Our song is a combination of two. Actually, Are You Washed in the Blood and All Fly Away. And in the middle, it just morphs one into the other. So it'll be on, the words will be on below, and you can just follow along. I know you can catch on. For the cleansing power, are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood? In the soul, in the blood of the Lamb. Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? As I remind you each week before we go, be safe, be smart, and be kind to each other as we go in peace and serve our Lord. Thanks be to God. We will see you next week. Take care. Pray that the snow melts and we don't get a whole lot more up here. And we love you all.